Thank you, everyone. Again, if you're just tuning in, that was Silver Linings, a piece that I composed, not originally for horn and harp, believe it or not. So when I'm not playing with Gus here or playing classical music, I love to play jazz. It's, I guess, one of my main passions in life. And I play with a jazz quartet, which is composed of a drummer, a bassist, a saxophonist, and myself. And although we haven't had much opportunity to play together these days, I'm looking forward to the day that we can do so again. But if you want to check out that sound, a sound that you might not be too familiar, please feel free to go to my website, check out my album Convergence that I put out a few years ago. It's got a lot of, or I guess it's just that tune that we've done today. But I really hope you enjoy and take a listen if you like what you're hearing today. Up next, I figure we'll take a transition back to classical land with just a gorgeous piece of music, this Notturno by Franz Strauss. Gus, if you feel comfortable, would you want to say a couple words about it?
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
so this piece was written by Franz Strauss, who was the father of the famous composer Richard Strauss. Franz Strauss was a lover of the classical composers like Mozart and Haydn, and not so much a lover of the later romantic composers like Wagner. In fact, he didn't like Wagner, and Wagner didn't like him very much, but Wagner did say that when, and Franz was a horn virtuoso. He played in the Munich Court Orchestra, and he played, funnily, the premieres of many Wagner operas. But Wagner said, you know, Strauss is a detestable fellow, but when he plays his horn, one can have no argument with him. So, but this is Franz Strauss, written when he was about 18 years old, the Notturno. And it's ordinarily for horn and piano. Charles does a beautiful job on the harp here, of course.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone, again, for joining us and listening. That, again, was Franz Strauss's Notturno, Opus 7.
Also nice to note that Charles and I did meet at Berklee. I was directing the film scoring orchestra, and Charles was the very competent harpist who could come in and play any part that any composer wrote. He further went on after that to become a fellow at the Tanglewood Music Center for a couple of summers, and one of the tasks that I was charged with at that point was arranging Die Frau ohne Schatten, the Strauss opera, for a suite of that for Andres Nelsons and the TMC brass, and two harps, one on either end of the giant brass section, and Charles was one of those harpists, and I'm greatly indebted to him for telling me what the harp notation should look like, because I had no idea. And he continues on, and yes, plays very often on the Symphony Hall stage with us in the BSO. So, and just, we've been wanting to collaborate for years, and sure. one of the good things about the pandemic and quarantine is that we've gotten to actually have time to get together and play some of this music that we've been so interested in doing together.
Yeah, absolutely. Up next, I think we will play the piece that actually brought us together in this pandemic. So back in June, as unfortunately racial tensions hit a high point in the United States, just like so many others, we were feeling deeply affected and unsure of next steps and what was the future of our country looking like. And like so many others, we took a breath and decided to listen and really listen to the voices that really needed to be heard. And out of that came a musical expression that we like to call "Listen to the Cry of Your Fellow Man." And this was a piece originally, I guess, brought to me by Gus. One morning, he was sitting to warm up, play some notes on the horn, and instead, this beautiful improvisation and pouring of color and sound came out, and he sent it over to me, and we went back and forth and in collaboration, and it's wound up to the point where it is today. And so we hope that through this musical expression, it'll encourage us all to really take a breath and listen, take stock of what's important, and just there's no need to talk sometimes we just need to listen. So this is "Listen to the Cry of Your Fellow Man." Thank you. Thank you all so much. Again, we really appreciate you being here with us, listening to us, taking the time out of your afternoon to spend some time with the French horn and the harp. Again, what an unusual combination, but as I hope you've heard, we really think that these two instruments were made to for each other in a lot of ways. Up next, I think I'm going to do a little solo rendition of something. I'm not going to preface this with anything. I hope everyone out there in the audience will recognize it. It's a familiar tune, and it's one of my favorite pieces to play. Thank you. tune. So I think in the spirit of in this sort of contemporary or jazz direction, we're going to play another popular tune that hopefully everyone knows. This is Yesterday. In case, in the very small chance that someone didn't happen to know that last tune, that was my favorite things, but hopefully everyone's familiar with that this afternoon. Again, that was Yesterday. I hope you enjoyed our little presentation here. And I think we're going to move into some questions if there are any from the chat.
Does anyone have any questions?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I just wanted to know how both of you got interested in these instruments.
Sure. I guess I can go first. It was quite an accident for me. I began playing violin, as so many of us do, and I just sounded absolutely terrible. I did not want to practice. I don't know how many of you have children that play the violin and are just starting out, but that shrieking, shrill sound right in your ear is just something that my little sensitive ears were not happy with, and I didn't want to put in the time to get better. But around fifth grade, luckily, the music teacher at my school was a harpist, and she had me try out a trial lesson. For whatever reason, she just said, go home, tell your that you want to play the harp. And I said, that's so strange. But I took that trial lesson, and I was just amazed that no matter what I did, I could not make this thing sound quite as terrible. You know, just this instrument is just, it lends itself to these beautiful lush tones, and just even a beginner can get something.
Sure, it's easy, sure.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
I don't know. What about you guys?
Yeah, I started on trumpet in fourth grade as you know, as kids, at least in my school, when they got to fourth grade, they got to choose an instrument. I chose the trumpet, and then the next year, my neighbor across the street chose the French horn. I just thought that looked a lot cooler. It had longer tubing and big bell on it and everything, and I thought that was kind of a cool thing. So my mom agreed to rent me a horn in seventh grade in the summer, and I never practiced. I was a terrible student. But somehow it stuck, and then I guess I got a couple of other good teachers and got into a youth orchestra, so I sort of gained a base of experience. But actually, I was playing in a rock band in high school. Of course, my older brothers all played in rock bands, and you know, I thought that was the coolest thing. So I played in a band, and I kind of wanted to do that. But my dad convinced me to go to school for at least 1 year, just go try it. So I went off and tried it. And then I kind of thought about what I really wanted to do, and I thought the horn kind of came easier to me than some other things. So what would happen if I actually worked at it? So I decided to actually work at it, and here I am still playing after my 40th season in the Boston Symphony.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Any other questions?
I was muted. Does anybody else have a question?
Yeah, Charles. In the two pieces, the Strauss and the Fauré, where you're playing a transcribed piano part, it sounded as if, you know, in the typical situation where the pianist would be bringing out the melody, it sounded as if you were bringing out the melody with a slightly different quality of sound. Is there anything that you do to the strings? It sounded more, it definitely sounded, yeah. You take it from there, please.
Sure. I mean, I guess that's plays into a bigger technical question of just the technique of the harp. And it's one of the things that I love so much about it is that although I'm constantly amazed by the wide variety of colors that pianists can find on the piano just with hammers, you know, there's a disconnect between their strings, and it's this mechanism that they somehow expertly wield control over, like playing on different pianos night to night and everything. And I'm amazed by it, but something I love about the harp is that it's just you and the instrument. You have direct contact with the strings, so every little, and it's for better or for worse, really, so every single detail, how you position your finger on the string, how you approach the string, how you leave the string, what part of the flesh are you using, are your nails too long? All these little things affect, like, dramatically the tone and the color that you're going to get. So yeah, that's just one of the things that I love about the instrument, and especially with this piano music, something that I frequently struggle with is just the idea that the piano is this, it's a little bit more percussive, and it sustains a good amount less. So getting the harp to sound clearly and presently is something that I've been learning to approach a little bit differently over these last, well, I mean, I guess I do it with a lot of different piano music, but especially in this context, I've been trying to be very cognizant of that. So without going into the nitty-gritty, just yes, it's a technical thing that I definitely consider when playing piano music especially. Oh, anything else?
I have to say that it's just amazing to hear these pieces played on harp for that very reason. There's a very sort of intimate touch to the release of the note, and it's kind of interesting. I was thinking, why does it seem like these two instruments blend or go well together? It seems like everything we try to play, we go, oh yeah, that works. Oh yeah, that works. I mean, there are some things that are maybe we haven't found yet that don't work so well, but maybe bebop or something. I'm not sure,
yeah.
Because I can't do it. But I think maybe because as soon as Charles plays the note, it's decaying right away. And the horn has the ability to just, you know, sort of bring the notes up or down or anything like that. That being said, if he rearticulates notes, you know, again and again, or plays a trill that grows or something like that, so he has the ability with a tremolo or something like that to actually build and make a shape of a sustained note. But other than that, him being plectrum and decay sort of contrasts nicely with the horn, which is, you know, as long as you're blowing the air over it, it's making a tone, and you have full control over whether it crescendos or decrescendos.
Right. And something that I've actually been excited about, or every time we play together, I think it hits me differently, but exactly what you said, the way the horn can sustain and the harp doesn't. I frequently, in chamber music settings with either violin, flute, or cello, that kind of tends to be an issue. Like a cellist will try to do a crescendo when I just have this sustained half note, and it's really ineffective. But something, at least I guess maybe it depends on the room, but something I've noticed is when you crescendo out of just me sustaining something, it feels like the harp almost gains in presence just because the two instruments blend so nicely together.
Probably some sympathetic vibration going on there.
I
felt that today, actually. Yeah.
Same. Yeah, yeah, that's exactly what it is. Yeah.
I think it's also the contrast of the two different sounds. They're both so beautiful in such different ways.
Yeah.
It's like the best of both worlds coming together.
We like it.
Anyway. Yeah.
We're having a great time.
And it's great in that space there.
Thank you.
It really is.
This has been my other pandemic project. I'm happy to say that I didn't hire a painter. My wife and I took on painting and doing all the woodwork. And we did have the floor guys come and sand the floors, and so they're nice and shiny. But that was really why we did it, because after we built the house 25 years ago, and it's nice that right now we're just putting stuff back in it, so there's no couch, so there's this giant music room with nothing in it, except now a horn and a harp. But thank you.
I have just a comment. I love, Charles, how you talk about music in terms of color, because my interest is more in the visual arts.
Oh, sure.
Or my background is, I should say, not necessarily my interest. And I just love that you made that connection between music and color.
Oh yeah, absolutely. For me at least, I mean, I think for all musicians, we try to find elements that take the sounds or the printed page beyond what it is, and, you know, so it can transcend and become something else. So something that always helps me is imagery. And that's what I share with my students a lot, is if you're having trouble connecting with a piece on an emotional level, just think about the scene that it's painting. Think about just what does this section look like to you? Any colors that pop out? Is it indoors, outdoors? Are there people involved? You know, these are tools that it feels too technical and cold to call them tools, but that's just where my mind goes when I when I think of music.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sylvia?
Hi, I just wanted to thank you so much. It was just such a gorgeous respite in the middle of the day. And I'm a pianist, and as pianists, we always try to pretend we're touching the strings and playing the harp. So everything you said to me really resonated, and it was just gorgeous, top to bottom. Just thank you so much.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks. Our pleasure.
The piece that you wrote together moved me to tears. Just stunning. Oh. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you again. Yeah.
Brenda, you're muted.
Me and the buttons. I keep hitting the wrong thing. Is anybody else up for a last question? I can just talk out because I can't see everybody.
Do you guys have another concert planned?
Not yet.
Not right? yet, but I'm sure we will.
We'll get there.
Yeah. So.
It was beautiful.
Good question. Thank you very much.
We appreciate it.
Beautiful.
Hi, Joy.
Hi. And I know Charles. I haven't seen you in a long time, but it was absolutely beautiful. So I'm so glad Clara contacted me. I didn't know about it. And it was absolutely beautiful. So thank you.
So glad you could join.
Thank you.
Can I hear
pleasure to bring music to real people.
Oh, it was so wonderful. And Charles, please say hi to your parents for me.
Oh, absolutely, will do.
Yeah.
They're doing great. Everyone's safe and healthy down in Virginia.
Oh,
but I'll be sure to give them your best.
I'm so glad to hear that. And again, always just a pleasure to hear both of you. And thank you so much. I mean, you just uplifted all of us this afternoon. And what a gift. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you both. If nobody has anything else to ask, it was beautiful. It definitely moved me. For people that don't know us as Music Mondays, if you wanted to follow our concerts, we do have a Facebook page called Music Mondays at the Scandinavian Center, because that's where we used to be live before the lockdown. And our next concert will be October 12th with a quartet from Juilliard School of Music. I want to thank you all for joining us. And again, thank these wonderful musicians. It was beautiful.
Bravo.
Good afternoon.